Okay, so we're setting off again today on another example of a Joondalup Lup test route. Now, as I said before, these are not absolutely guaranteed test routes. They are just the sorts of places that people get taken to in their tests. As we drive through this car park, it's about a fast walking pace, about 10 kilometres an hour. And coming out here to the stop sign intersection as we leave the car park. Now, you could get asked to turn right here, you could get asked to go straight ahead, or you could turn left. You've got to be good at all of those possibilities. And we have a video on exactly that subject. So you need to go and watch that video. That will show you all of the possible scenarios that you could encounter at that stop sign or any other stop sign with a similar configuration. And you need to know how to deal with all those different circumstances. So we just move up to here and wait for this car. And we're going to wait for the bus as well. Okay, turning right down this street. Now you notice there is no painted white line on the left-hand side of this road. It's just a piece of concrete and a bit of brick paving. That is all road. We drive on the bitumen because it's the most sensible place to drive here. But when we come down to turn this corner, we have the use of all of the road. So we just check what's behind us and we come around here and use all of these different road surfaces to turn the corner. We can clip this white line, that's okay. Now there is a white line, there's definitely a bike lane there. We need to be aware of any bikes that might be behind us. We're turning left down here at this corner. Checking mirrors, maybe a quick check at the blind spot if you're not sure about bikes. Okay, if you hear a siren, just be aware of where the emergency vehicle is and give way if necessary. Okay, straight ahead on this road through this roundabout. Now it's a two-lane roundabout, we must stick to our lane, the left of this white line, indicating off the roundabout, of course. And we're going to turn right at the traffic lights. That indicator was for the lane change. This is for moving across to the slip lane. We go directly to the left-hand lane here. This is the default driving lane. Just gone past a speed sign there that says 50 kilometres an hour. You've got to be very careful that you don't exceed the speed limit on this road. This road creates the illusion of a higher speed limit given that it's a dual carriageway and two lanes in both directions. If you drove onto this road from a side street, you wouldn't necessarily see a speed sign. You've got to understand that it's a built-up area, and built-up areas have a speed limit of 50, unless they're otherwise signposted. So I'm driving on exactly 50 on my speedo. The speedo on the camera will be reading a bit slower because that's running off GPS. Car speedos generally overstate by a little bit. But in your driving test, you drive to the car's speedo, regardless of its accuracy. Okay, as we come down here, just a quick glance to the right, a quick glance to the left. It's not absolutely necessary in the driving test to do that, but it's a very good idea as a driver to keep yourself safe. Okay, here are two signs, two 70k signs. That's a change of speed limit. So we don't speed up until we get there. But now we're in a 70 zone. People fail a lot because they see the speed signs up ahead and don't register that there are two signs. When there are two signs together, like those 70 signs back there, that is a change of speed zone. And you cannot speed up to the higher limit until you enter that speed zone by passing those signs. And similarly, when you see two signs ahead of you that have a lower speed limit, again, the new speed zone commences at those signs, so you must slow down by the time you get to those. Okay, taking the first exit off this roundabout. And now we're going to look for somewhere safe and legal to park the car. Okay, so the indicator's off, the car's in park. Okay, we're here because we're going to do the second section of the driving test, which is, in this case, it's going to be an exercise called Left Something Behind. So we're parked on the side of the road, and the assessor will explain the situation. We're going to drive away from here. We need to take note of where we are, so we're just near that car park on our left there, which you probably can't see through the camera, but car park in a child's play area. We park just adjacent to that. We're going to drive down this street, and at some point the assessor is going to tell you that you've left something behind. Now you will need to turn the vehicle around safely and legally, come back in the opposite direction, drive past where we are at the moment, and then turn around a second time and come back and park in the same position or close by if that same position isn't available. So they'll be marking you on the two turnarounds and on the general driving during the exercise. You're meant to take an early option in terms of a method of turning around. So you, if a number of driveways were presenting themselves and there was no side street available for quite some distance, you'd be expected to use a driveway to turn around. So don't work on the basis that you're always going to be using side streets. It is quite feasible that you'll need to use driveways to turn the car around, but you need to pick good options. You don't want to pick driveways with hedges coming right down to the road, with large vehicles parked on the verge, with other vehicles parked on the road nearby. So you've got a choice. If you've got a choice of driveways, you've got to make a good choice and make it a safe choice. So we're going to head off from here. We check our mirrors. There's nobody coming, so we'll indicate, check our blind spot, and move away and cancel the indicator. And at some point, the assessor is going to tell you that you've left something behind. Now, we don't know exactly when, but it could be coming up at any moment. At this stage, we're just happily driving along. Okay, you've left something behind, and you need to go back and park where you were. All right, so there's a bit of a bend in the road here. Lots of driveways, no side streets. Here's a nice straight stretch of road. Let's find a driveway to turn around in. Okay, they're pretty much double width driveways, most of these. Here's a good one right here. So coming down here, we'll enter on the left-hand side of the driveway, and we'll angle ourselves across to the right somewhat. Just get the car off the road, don't go past the letterbox, straighten the wheels up. Put the car in reverse. Now look up and down the street. Yes, it's clear, so promptly get back on the road. Get yourself nice and straight. Got to make sure you're on your side of the road. Put the car into drive. Now check your central mirror and your right mirror, indicate to the right, check your blind spot to the right, move away and cancel the indicator. Now that's your first turnaround. Now we're heading back to where we were. Now in this case it's quite some distance. You've got to memorise where you were, but it's not that difficult. It's not a navigation exercise so much as it's a driving exercise, but you do need an awareness of roughly where you are. Okay. Coming up now towards the park again, there's the child's play equipment. There is the car park on the right hand side. So we've gone past where we were parked. We need to turn around somewhere. Now here is a good opportunity. Here's a side street. Come up close to the centre of the road without being over the centre. Come almost past the intersection. Now turn sharply around in a semicircular path or an elliptical path. Coming back towards the road, now we change our indicator to left. Before we re-enter the road, we check over our right shoulder, make sure it's clear, come back onto the road, and now we indicate left, check our mirror, move in towards the curb, park the car. Pick the appropriate gear, in this case, for an automatic car, it's park, turn the indicator off, and that is the end of that exercise. It's pretty straightforward, but you've just got to do those maneuvers safely. Now, if you were in that particular manoeuvre and we saw all of those driveways presented and you ignored the driveways and kept on driving looking for a side street, you would probably lose a mark for missed opportunities, and you just need to come up with an option. That's part of the exercise, is being able to make decisions under pressure. So if you see a multitude of driveways and no side streets and nowhere else to turn around, then that's where your choice is going to be. Now, some of those driveways might not be absolutely ideal, but you've got to pick the best of what you've got. Okay, now we're going to move away and we're going to do section 3 of the test, which is just a general point-to-point driving. Okay, we checked our mirrors, we indicated, we moved away from the curb, we cancelled the indicator, we checked our blind spot as well, of course. Now, I mentioned earlier on that, you know, there's no such thing as a standard driving test, and you can't just assume that you're going to go to all the stock standard places to do your test. You can't just look at one video. We've got a couple of driving test routes videos up at the moment. We've had them up for a few months, and what we've noticed is that about double of the number of viewers watch the first video compared to the second video. So a lot of driving test candidates are just scrimping on their practice, and they're doing the bare minimum, and they're thinking to themselves, if they've watched one driving test route video, then that's enough. Now, that's not good enough. You need to avail yourself to all of the available material and give yourself the maximum chance of passing your test. So if there are multiple driving test route videos available to browse, then watch them. Now, this is an adult pastime, driving, and you've got to approach the driving test as an adult. You're not going to get a merit certificate for doing well. You're not going to get a participation award because you did your test. You've got to actually pass the thing. Now, here's a surprise. We're going on the freeway. Some people think that you never go on the freeway in your driving test. Well, that's a fallacy. People do go on the freeway in their driving test, and if you haven't been practicing on the freeway, then you're likely to come unstuck when you have to deal with lots of traffic at high speed. Now, first of all, we've got a merge point here. We check our mirrors, we indicate, we check our blind spot. Now, when we get up to here, it's up to 100. Now, we've got to work our way onto the freeway at this merge point. So, we try to get ourselves up to speed. Here is the merge point. We check our mirrors, we indicate, we check our blind spot, it's safe, we move out, and we cancel the indicator. When you're doing that, get your indicator on, let people know that you want to move out. I mean, it's pretty obvious that you do, but don't just sit there waiting for a gap before you put your indicator on. Okay, now, you need to be able to drive at a reasonable speed along here, just keeping up with the traffic flow. I'm doing just around 100, maybe just under. And we're not going to stay on the freeway for long. It's your driving test. You've only got half an hour. We're going to exit the freeway here. Indicator on. Don't slow down yet. Let's get off the freeway. Keep up with the traffic flow. Okay. We can cancel the indicator now because that was just to get onto the slip road. And now here is a change of limit. It's 70 when we hit these signs. We must have slowed down by the time we get to the signs. Here we go. Just under 70. Now we have two lanes turning right. And we are going to turn right again sometime soon. So we're happy to be in this lane for now. Could be in the other lane, but when you do come to turn right later on, you're going to need to do it from the right-hand lane. But there you go. There's a rumour going around that you never go on the freeway in your driving test. That's absolutely false. It's not all that common to go on the freeway in your driving test, but it does happen. Following the lines around here to get onto the correct lane. Okay, turning right up here and moving back into the built-up area. Okay, build-up area, what's the speed limit? Of course, it's 50. That's the default. Okay, we're just regularly checking our mirrors. About every 10 seconds or so, you check your mirror. Also check your mirror before you apply the brakes. Okay, just more driving in the built-up area. So we try and stick within 5 km of the speed limit. You don't try and hover right around the speed limit in your driving test. There's a danger that you may stray over. So anything within about 5 km of the limit is fine. Okay, there's the 40K sign for the school zones. It's not school zone time at the moment, so it is 50. You need to be aware of where your clock is located in your car so that you can know at any moment when you glance at your instruments, you need to know what the time is. Because you could be doing your test around about the time that school zones kick in or conclude. Okay, just indicating off the roundabout. Now we are going to do an exercise called stopping for shopping. The car park that we're going to go to is on our left, but for now we're going to head off to our right. And the assessor might ask you round about now to find somewhere to park the car. We're going to pull over and park just up here. We're going to avoid driveways. There is a driveway just in front of us here. We're keeping away from side streets. And we've parked on a bit of a hill. Now, there is one extra thing that you may do on a hill, and that is to turn your steering wheel half a turn to the left. And the reason for that is that if you parked the car and walked away and there was some mechanical issue or some driver error that then led to the car rolling away when you weren't in control of the car, you would not want the car to roll down the hill in a straight line. You would want it to go off in some direction that would cause it to either stop on the side of a hill or hit some object, hopefully doing minimal damage to property and to people, as opposed to just rolling in a straight line for a long distance, picking up speed as it goes and causing potentially a lot of harm. So you don't necessarily get marked for it. It depends on the assessor on the day, but on occasions you may be asked after you've parked whether there's something else that you might consider doing in this situation, and it's most likely going to be the half turn of the wheel towards the curb. Now, there is this concept of dry steering, static steering, where you're not meant to turn the wheel when the car's not moving. However, there is an allowance for half a turn of the steering wheel. So the simplest way to do the maneuver is to come up and park in a straight line and then do your half turn after you've stopped. Some people do teach a fancy way of coming up and doing a bit of a shimmy as you come up and then doing the turn just before you stop, but it is prone to cause you to be a bit crooked. So keep it simple and just come up, park the car, do the half turn. If you don't do the half turn, you're not going to fail your test for not doing it. The worst that would happen is you might lose a mark on your test, but it's quite likely that you might get a subtle prompt from the assessor just asking you whether there's something else you might consider doing, and it's most likely, as I said, most likely going to be the half turn of the wheel. Now we're going to go back to that car park and do a reverse park. That's the stopping for shopping exercise. In this case, because we've parked on the side of the road away from the car park, we're going to be marked on two manoeuvres. One will be the first turnaround. We're going to use a side street to turn around. And the second will be the actual reverse parking manoeuvre in the car park. So, put the car into drive. We check our mirrors and see who's behind us. There's nobody coming, so we indicate, we check our blind spot. As we move away, we just correct that half turn of the wheel and cancel the indicator. All right, we're going to turn around here. So left indicator coming in. Just follow the curb in. Make sure there's nobody coming out of this street. Okay, change our indicator. Now change our direction. And before we re-enter the road, check up and down the street. Yes, it's clear. And away we go down the hill towards the T-junction where we'll turn left and then head towards the entry to the car park. Curb as we turn the corner, waiting for traffic coming from our right. Okay, now there's a little red bit of road here. We're just going to get ourselves positioned into that just in case we got stuck here and we could let traffic go past us. into the car park. Here's the T-junction indicating left, looking both ways, and coming down here and parking on the left using whatever method you use. I use the three-line method, parking on the left in reverse. If you're going to count lines, make sure you watch ahead as you're doing it. Looking around in all directions before you start reversing, and then just keeping yourself on track. Still looking around as you go. When you get yourself to the position where you're straight, quickly straighten your wheel up. And as you're coming in, looking around and then picking a point to stop. Now, when you stop, it's either when your shoulder is halfway along the length of the white lines next to you, or if you've got a reversing camera, you have a glance at the camera and just see what the gap is. You're not meant to be totally reliant on cameras, because not all cars have them, but they are a safety device and you should use them, otherwise you're being a bit negligent. When I say use them to the same extent that you would use any other mirror, or to the extent that you'd be looking around, looking side to side behind you. It's just another tool that you can use to have an awareness of what's happening 360 degrees around you. Okay, so we're in the parking bay. You're being marked on looking around, you're being marked on the smoothness of your maneuver and your accuracy. And if you do mess it up, you need the ability to be able to fix it. Now, if you mess it up and it's quite clear to you that you're not anywhere near central or you're crooked, then take it upon yourself to fix it. But it's possible that in your nervousness of the test, you might just think that that's okay, or you're not sure that you're allowed to fix it or whatever. But no, if you're in a shopping center car park and you messed your parking up, what would you do? You'd fix it. So assessors are aware of that. Now, if you choose not to fix it, you may get a subtle prompt from the assessor. The assessor asks you whether you're happy with your parking, whether you're all done, whether you're all good, various other expressions. Just think about why they are asking you a question about your parking. It may be that they're giving you a prompt to say, hey, this isn't quite good enough, maybe you should consider fixing it. As the driving test candidate, you should be aware of the fact that you can fix your parking. So go ahead and do it. If they follow up with a secondary prompt asking you, if you say yes, you're happy with your parking, and they follow you up with a secondary prompt saying, are you sure about that? Then just take it on board. They're giving you a bit of assistance to the extent that they're allowed to. They're not telling you what to do. They're just asking you whether you're happy, and you can make that decision for yourself. Okay, that's the end of section 4. Then you'd be heading back to the licensing centre. Okay, so we look up and down this car park. We indicate right. We move out of the car park on the correct side of the road. We make sure we don't cut this corner on the exit. There could be somebody coming in. Watch out for the footpath as you're coming back out to the road. There could be a motorised scooter flying along the footpath. And away we go. Again, it's a 50k built up area. School zone's finished. It wasn't school zone time anyhow. But when you're in a school zone, make sure that you do keep an eye out for the end of school zone signs. Because if you don't spot them, how are you going to know when to start speeding up over 40? So there are certain signs that you need to be aware of, and other signs you don't need to worry about. There's all sorts of stuff. There's speed signs, there's advisory signs, school zone signs. A multitude of signs that are relevant to you, but there are also others that aren't necessarily relevant, advertising signs and that sort of stuff. We're just checking our mirror regularly as we drive along, every 10 seconds or so. So having completed sections 1 through to 4, you've now got to make sure you get back to the licensing centre unscathed in section 5. So just keep concentrating. You've probably at this stage done about 20 to 25 minutes of your test. You've just got to hold it together all the way back, making sure that we don't speed, we abide by the road rules, we check our mirrors to the correct extent, and we apply correct giveaway rules, etc. and so forth. Okay, coming down here, we're going to turn left. We check our mirror. The brakes. As we come down to this giveway line, we just start to turn the corner before we get to the line. and we move out onto this road. Now, there is no speed sign on this road. Now, if you're aware, if you're completely aware of where you are, then you know that it's 70 on this road. But if you're new to the area, it's probably safer just to do the default speed limit of 50 and just say to the assessor, I don't know the speed limit, I'm going to assume that it's 50. Now, the assessor may well tell you the speed limit, or they might leave it for you to work out for yourself. There is a speed sign just ahead here. In fact, there are two signs, so it's a change of speed limit. Okay, coming through the traffic lights. Just an awareness of whether it's safe. Check to the right, check to the left. Here's the change of speed limit. From this point onward, it's going to be 50. Just keeping 2 seconds behind the car in front, so we're going to go a little bit slow here. We've got to either overtake them or just go a bit slow and keep up with them. No point in overtaking because they are gradually speeding up. And we're just hovering around that 46 to 49 sort of speed, just under 50. As I said, the GPS on the camera will show it's a bit slower than that, but we're driving to our car's speedo. Don't try and keep up with the other traffic, because a lot of those people are speeding. Now we've got a merge point coming up. Normally you check your mirrors, you'd indicate you check your blind spot and move over. We are going to check our mirrors, we're going to check our blind spot and stay left. We're going to get past this side street. Now we're going to indicate left and we're going to go across these solid white lines because we are turning left up here at the traffic lights. There was no point in us first of all merging, otherwise we would have been sitting in that queue of cars that were going straight ahead. We just make a beeline straight for the turning lane. Now we're going to turn left and then turn right. So let's go directly to the right hand lane as we turn the corner. We do it as we turn the corner, we don't need to change our indicator. And we're turning right at the first opportunity, which is this roundabout. Past the second exit, we indicate left for the third exit. Cancel the indicator if it doesn't self-cancel. And although the speed limit's 50, we're doing an appropriate speed for this road with its various hazards. We've got cars pulling out of parking spaces, we've got pedestrians. All sorts of reasons why you wouldn't be driving right on the limit. Okay, coming up here to the stop sign. We just focus on the line and we stop completely. Then we look around and see. Now we've got a person turning in front of us who shouldn't have done so. Just waiting for traffic to clear. Okay, back into the car park. And an appropriate car park speed is a fast walking pace of about 10. And we've made it through to the end of our test. We're now just trying to find somewhere to park the car. So we'll probably just go into one of these bays down here. Okay, here's a forward park on the right, on the left. We go wide to the right, we look over our left shoulder here. And we just come into this bay. Into park, and you turn the car off. And that's the end of the test. So as you can see from that, there are variations on the routes that are taken on driving tests. You've got to be good at all aspects of driving. Who would have thought that you'd go on the freeway in your driving test? But it does happen sometimes. So you've just got to be prepared for it by doing adequate practice on all aspects of driving. There are other videos we've done previously. You need, as I said earlier on, you need to watch all of those videos. Do lots and lots of driving in the test area, lots of driving just generally, but also just make yourself familiar with the test area.